Now that we have a firm grasp on how science regards facts and theories, let's explore the theory of evolution. You may remember teen heartthrob Kirk Cameron as Mike Seaver on the 80s sitcom Growing Pains. However, these days, Kirk is an evangelical Christian that speaks out against evolution, with his cohort Christian author Ray Comfort.
Behold the atheist's nightmare. Now, if you study a well-made banana, you'll find on the far side, there are three ridges. On the close side, two ridges. If you get your hand ready to grip a banana, you'll find on the far side, there are three grooves. On the close side, two grooves. The banana and the hand are perfectly made one for the other. You'll find the maker of the banana, Almighty God, has made it with a non-slip surface. It has outward indicators of inward contents. Green, too early. Yellow, just right. Black, too late. Now, if you go to the top of the banana, you'll find, as with the soda can makers, they placed a tab at the top. So God has placed a tab at the top. When you pull the tab, the contents don't squirt in your face. You'll find the wrapper, which is biodegradable, has perforations. Notice how gracefully it sits over the human hand. Notice it has a point at the top for ease of entry. It's just the right shape for the human mouth. It's chewy, easy to digest, and it's even curved toward the face to make the whole process so much easier. Seriously, Kirk, the whole of creation testifies to the genius of God's creative hand.
It absolutely does.
The argument presented by Ray Comfort at best displays a blatant lack of fact-checking, and at worst is an outright lie. If Kirk and Ray would have taken 2 minutes to type the word banana into Wikipedia and scroll down to the section Early Cultivation, they would have found the banana has been cultivated in Papua New Guinea for the past 5,000 to 8,000 years. Not only that, just below we find an image of the wild banana pre-cultivation. As you can see, the wild-type banana bears little resemblance to its cultivated form. It contains relatively little fruit, it is full of large seeds, it does not easily fit in the palm of one's hand, and I imagine it would be much more difficult to eat than how Ray so graciously demonstrates. For a religion that places such emphasis on honesty, creationists seem more than eager to blatantly manipulate facts and spread misinformation, so long as it serves to advance their religiously biased views. Obviously, the banana as we know it today was not specifically designed by God with the ease of human consumption in mind. In fact, quite the contrary, the modern banana is a product of human ingenuity, created through generations of selective breeding. Essentially, selective breeding is evolution controlled by man. When we find traits in a plant or animal deemed important, we select a specimen for breeding in order to propagate said traits within the following generations. Darwin's mechanism of natural selection works exactly the same way, but instead nature, not man, determines which animals will pass on their genetic information based on who is best at finding food and who is most successful in securing a mate. The animals best adapt at exploiting the resources of their habitat will go on to pass these beneficial attributes to their offspring. With each generation, the population becomes more and more specialized until the very anatomy and physiology of the species is attuned to that specific ecosystem. Now, what happens when the environment changes, where a certain group within the greater population moves away from its normal habitat, where they were once specialists, and find themselves in a location where food is not so easily obtained? Well, the process starts itself over again. The members of the population who find themselves struggling to secure resources will die out, and the others who can find food and successfully mate will survive, allowing their offspring to gradually become more and more adapted to the new environment. If two groups in a population remain isolated from one another in comparatively different habitats, eventually they will have accumulated so many adaptations, their genetic information will no longer be compatible. This means if two members of each group were to reunite and attempt to mate, there will be one of two outcomes. The first would be a failure to produce viable offspring, such as if a chimpanzee were to mate with a baboon. The second possible outcome would be successful reproduction, but the resultant offspring would be infertile, which can be observed when horses from the Asian continent are bred with zebras from Africa. The inability to produce viable offspring is what defines different species. Darwin was the first to document this phenomenon on November 24, 1859, in his groundbreaking publication, On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection. Darwin's realizations were truly radical for his time, for not only did it challenge the prevailing scientific understanding of biology, it shook the very foundations of Western culture and religion. In the 1700s, biology in Europe and America was dominated by natural theology, a philosophy dedicated to discovering the Creator's plan by studying nature. Natural theologians saw the adaptations of organisms as evidence that the Creator had designed each and every species for a particular purpose. A major objective in natural theology was to classify species in order to reveal the hierarchy of life that God had created. Carlos Linnaeus, a Swedish physician and botanist, sought to discover the order and the diversity of life for the greater glory of God. Linnaeus was the founder of taxonomy, a branch of biology concerned with naming and classifying the diverse forms of life. He developed the two-part classification system of genus and species still used today. To Linnaeus, clustering similar species together implied kinship. But a century later, his taxonomic system would become a focal point in Darwin's arguments for evolution. Charles Darwin was fascinated with nature as a child. However, Darwin's father, an eminent physician, sent Charles to study medicine at the age of 16. Charles disliked medicine, and after a few years, he enrolled at Christ College at Cambridge University with the intent of becoming a clergyman. At the age of 22, Darwin finished his degree and was recommended to Captain Robert Fitzroy, who was preparing a survey ship, the HMS Beagle, for a voyage around the world. The primary mission of the voyage was to chart poorly known stretches of South American coastline. While the ship's crew surveyed the coast, Darwin spent most of his time on shore, observing and collecting hundreds of specimens of the exotic and diverse flora and fauna of South America. He noticed that plants and animals on the continent had definite South American characteristics, very different from those of Europe. That in itself may have not been surprising, but Darwin also noted that plants and animals in temperate regions of South America were more closely related to species living in tropical regions of that continent than to species living in temperate regions of Europe. The geographical distribution of species perplexed Darwin, especially puzzling was the fauna of the Galapagos, islands of relatively recent volcanic origin. Most of the species living on the Galapagos live nowhere else in the world, although they resemble species living on the South American mainland. Darwin began to wonder why God had bothered creating so many different but very similar species of animals. It appeared to him as if these varieties of animals came from one another and were not individually created for a specific purpose. Among the birds Darwin collected on the Galapagos were 13 types of finches that, although quite similar, physically differed from one another, especially in the size of their beaks. Soon after returning to Great Britain in 1836, Darwin started reassessing all that he observed. He began to perceive the origins of new species and adaptations to the environment as closely related processes. It occurred to him that new species could arise from an ancestral form by the gradual accumulation of adaptations to different environments. This hypothesis for the origin of species predicted that, over many generations, two populations could become dissimilar enough to be designated separate species. Darwin saw unity in life, with all organisms related through descent from an unknown prototype that lived in the remote past. As descendants of the original organism spilled into various habitats over millions of years, they accumulated diverse modifications or adaptations that fit them to specific ways of life. All life, even that of humans, developed from a common ancestor, an evolutionary lineage we share with primates.